Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum
assalam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. I welcome you to a class that is sponsored by the London Institute entitled Denial, Tafseer Surat Ya-Sin and Surat Ar-Rahman. And in this class, as the title indicates, we will be talking about two surahs of the Quran that are very popular and very commonly read in salawat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for these two surahs a special love. These surahs are popular and common amongst the ummah. And even though the both of them don't have a direct linkage, i.e. the two of them were not revealed back to back, still the content of these two surahs is actually very similar. We will see as we go over our tafsir of these two surahs, we will see that in fact the main theme of these surahs and the main points that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, they're actually very similar to one another. And we will begin with Surah Yaseen and finish up Yaseen inshaAllah ta'ala tomorrow. And then Surah Rahman will be done all of Sunday. Surah Rahman will be done all of Sunday. And before we begin the actual tafsir of Surah Yaseen and Rahman, just a very quick few minutes introduction to why we have to study tafsir. What is the goal of tafsir? Somebody might ask, didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal the Quran so that everybody could benefit? Why can't we just open up the Quran and read it ourselves and benefit from the Quran? The response to this is, one needs to be very careful in understanding one's own limitations and roles before extracting meanings of the Quran. It is true that Allah says, we have made the Quran easy for understanding, so who is there that will understand? It is true that Allah wants us to read the Quran, yet at the same time, the average Muslim is not qualified to derive rulings or legislation or theology directly from the Quran. Rather, the average Muslim can obtain the basic meaning of the Quran. This is true. But there are deeper meanings that you need knowledge in order to unlock. And the more knowledge one gains, the more that one can extract from the Quran. So for example, Surat Al-Ikhlas. Every one of you, without having any knowledge of tafsir, can read the surah and get the gist of it. And that is, Allah is saying He's one, He's unique, there's nothing like Him, that He doesn't have children, neither does He make nor is He begotten. This is a very basic understanding. The more higher level you go, the more wisdom you will be able to extract. Somebody will say, why is Allah saying Qul? What is the wisdom of Qul? Right? Why did Allah use the name Ahad and not Wahid? And what is the difference between Ahad and Wahid? Right? The word Samad, which is His divine attribute, it only occurs in Surah Al-Ikhlas. Nowhere in the whole Quran does Allah use the word Samad. What does it really mean? What are the 17 different interpretations of Samad? This is another level, right? And the purpose of revelation. And why did Allah say it? And so on and so forth. So, it is possible to give a tafsir of Surah Al-Ikhlas that will take an entire day. And once a person understands what tafsir does, without tafsir, it is as if you have never read the Quran. One of the famous scholars of the past, his name is Iyas ibn Muawiyah. Iyas ibn Muawiyah said, the parable of tafsir, is like a group of people who receive a letter from their king in the middle of the night. They receive a letter from their king in the middle of the night, but they don't have a light to read the letter with. Tafsir is like a man who comes with the light. A man who comes with the light, it is as if he has opened up the meanings of the Quran for them. And this is something that is so true, that once you take tafsir of any surah, inshallah you will see even this weekend, it is as if you will tell yourself, I never understood the surah before this. I never appreciated the surah before this. And when you understand what tafsir can give you, you will have a desire to go beyond a mere translation, to go beyond a mere basic understanding, and you will want to unlock each and every miracle and blessing and understanding of the Quran. So we will begin today with the tafsir of Surah Yaseen. أعوذ begin with the tafsir of Surah Yaseen, and we begin by talking about the names of Surah Yaseen. The names of Surah Yaseen. Now, why do we begin with the name? Why do we begin by talking about the names of the surah? The response: the names of the surah, they come from primarily the Sahaba and not the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Most of the names of the surahs of the Quran, they don't come from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not name most of the surahs. Yes, it is true he named some of the surahs. So he named Surah Al-Baqarah and he named Surah Ali Imran. But most of the surahs of the Quran, their names have not been mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many times he would reference a surah by simply talking about the first verse. For example, a hadith in Sahih Muslim, he said, there is a surah in the Quran that is composed of 30 verses. Whoever memorizes it, Allah will protect him from the punishment of the grave. Then he said, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. He didn't say Surah Tabarak. He didn't say Surah Mulk. Rather, he simply said, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكُ, and everybody understood which surah he intended. So, it is because of this that to this day, the surahs of the Quran, we find a variety, not just one name. It is because of this that surahs of the Quran, you have had multiple names for the same surah. Surah Al-Baqarah has more than 15 names. Surah Al-Fatiha has more than 20 names. And these names, most of them, they come from the Sahaba and Tabi'un. They come from the earliest scholars. And it demonstrates, these names, how the Sahaba viewed these surahs. What was the perception of the Sahaba to these surahs? It demonstrates the perspective that the Sahaba had to these particular surahs. And because of these differences of names, as I said, to this day, we have multiple names for the same surah in the Quran. For example, who can give me an example of the same surah with two different names? For example, what? Surah Isra is called what? Bani Israel. What else? Which one? What is Baqarah called besides Baqarah? What else? Two other names.
Iqra.
Iqra is called?
Alaq.
Iqra is called Alaq. What else? There's so many examples. What else? Mu'min is called? Ghafir. Ghafir and Mu'min. What else? Surah Tawbah is called? Barama. Surah Tawbah is also called Surah Barama, right? Surah Insan is called? Surah Dahab. So we see all of these differences for the same surah name. And by the way, there are many more than these, but these differences trickle down, so we find them to this day in the Quran. So what are some of the names of Surah Yaseen that are mentioned in the early tradition? Of the names of Surah Yaseen, number one, it is called Al-Mudafi'ah with a dal. Al-Mudafi'ah with a dal. Al-Mudafi'ah. And the meaning of Mudafi'ah is that which repels. That which repels. So the Sahaba called it Al-Mudafi'ah because they thought that Yaseen repels evil from you. Yaseen repels evil away from you. It protects you from evil, Al-Mudafi'ah. Another name of Surah Yaseen is Al-Qadiyah with a dad. Al-Qadiyah with a dad. And Al-Qadiyah means it gives you what you want. It gives you what you want. Because they felt when you read Surah Yaseen, you will get your goal. You will get what you want. And a third name of Yaseen is Al-Mu'ammimah with an Ayn and Meem. Al-Mu'ammimah, two Meems. Ayn, Meem, Meem, and Ta-Mabruda. Al-Mu'ammimah. And Al-Mu'ammimah, it means that which envelopes you. That which covers you up. Because they felt that Surah Yaseen covers you in Allah's mercy. Surah Yaseen envelopes you in Allah's mercy. So when you look at these surah names, you find that the Sahaba, they very much value Surah Yaseen. They consider Surah Yaseen to be an amazing surah. It gives you what you want. It repels evil. It envelopes you in Allah's mercy. These are all of the names that are given to Surah Yaseen. And Surah Yaseen is a Meccan Surah almost by unanimous consensus. Surah Yaseen is a Makki Surah. Now what does this mean? The Surahs of the Quran are divided into two categories, Madani and Makki. And Makki Surahs are those Surahs that have been revealed before the Hijrah. And Madani Surahs are those Surahs that have been revealed after the Hijrah. And if you look at the Quran, you notice that there is a very big difference between the Makki and the Madani Surahs in terms of style, in terms of context, in terms of content. We find marked difference between the two. Makki Surahs, for example, their ayat are very short, usually. And there are very powerful rhythms, rhymes. And the content deals with Tawheed of Allah, morality, Yawm al-Akhir, stories of the previous prophets. For example, look at Juz Amma, most of it is Makki. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا وَالْلَيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا. Look at the rhythm of these surahs. Madani surahs, generally speaking, have longer verses. And their style and rhythm is very different. Look at Surah Baqarah, which is Madani. Sometimes an ayah is an entire page. And usually ayat are 2-3 lines. Whereas Makki surahs are short ayat. The content of Madani surahs, all of the laws came down in Medina. How to pray, zakat, hajj, Ramadan, inheritance, they're all Madani. So Surah Yaseen is a Makki surah. And because it is a Makki surah, it is an example that exemplifies Makki attributes. Short ayat, Yaseen, Wal-Qur'an al-Hakim, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ تَنْزِيلَ الْعَزِيزَ الرَّحِيمِ. The power and the rhythm and the rhyme is Makki. We just look at the notice, right? The content of the surah concentrates on Allah, the Messenger, the final day, resurrection, stories of the previous prophets. This is the standard Makki context. This is what Makki surahs generally are about. And of the primary themes of Surah Yaseen, is to prove the Day of Judgment and to prove the resurrection of mankind. And also of the primary themes of Surah Yaseen is to prove that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a true prophet. That the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a true prophet. And Surah Yaseen, it has many blessings narrated about it. It has many ahadith about it. But amazingly and strangely, there's a lot of discussion regarding the authenticity of these ahadith. So we will discuss 5 such traditions, and this is basically the most common of all of these ahadith of Surah Yaseen. We will discuss 5 of these traditions narrated about Surah Yaseen. The first hadith that talks about the blessings of Yaseen is a hadith that talks about the blessings of all the surahs of the Quran generically. Just a simple hadith that praises the entire Quran and categorizes the Quran into 4 different categories. Waqil ibn al-Asqa narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I have been given, in place of the Torah, I have been given the long, 7 long surahs, the Sab'a Tiwal. So he says, instead of the Torah, I have been given the 7 long surahs. And instead of the Zabur, I have been given the Mi'in surahs. The Mi'in surahs, just write it down and I'll explain one by one. Instead of the Zabur, Allah has given me the Mi'in surahs. And instead of the Injil, Allah has given me the Mathani surahs. Instead of the Injil, I have the Mathani. And I have been blessed over all the other prophets with the Mufassal surahs. The Mufassal surahs. So in this hadith, our Prophet divided the Quran into 4 categories. And this hadith is narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Muslim, and it is an authentic hadith. So what does this hadith tell us? This hadith tells us that the Quran incorporates all of the previous books and it has extra than the previous books. The Quran incorporates all of the previous books and it has more than that. How so? Our Prophet said, instead of the Torah, I have been given the seven long surahs. And scholars say the seven long surahs, they are from Baqarah all the way till Tawbah, and because they consider Tawbah and Al-Fajr to be basically one surah, so technically they include eight, even though the Prophet said seven long, they include Tawbah and Al-Fajr. So from surah number 2 all the way to surah number 9, they said this is the equivalent of the Torah. Now, what is the Torah known for? What is the Torah known for?
Laws.
And if you look at these surahs, you find that they are full of laws. Pretty much all of our laws of the Sharia, almost all of them, they occur in these surahs. Marriage and divorce and inheritance and hajj and fasting, all of this occurs in this section, generally, of course. Then instead of the Zabur, I have been given the Mi'in. The Mi'in is those surahs that have around 100 ayat, that's why they're called Mi'in. Around 100 ayat. And generally speaking, the scholars say this is from Surah Yunus to Surah Fatir. Surah Yunus to Surah Fatir are the Mi'in. And the Zabur was known for praising Allah. And these surahs are full of tasbih and tahmeed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praising Allah. Then he said, instead of the Injil, I have been given the Mathani. And Mathani means the surahs that are recited frequently. The frequently recited surahs. And the Mathani is from Yaseen to Tujurah. So Yaseen begins the Mathani. Yaseen begins the Mathani. From Yaseen to Tujurah is the Mathani. And then he said, I have been preferred over all the other prophets with the Mufassal. And the Mufassal are from Surah Qaf to Surah Nas. Qaf to Nas. And what does Mufassal mean? Mufassal means that which has lots of breaks in between. And they are called Mufassal because the surahs are short, so there's lots of breaks. Look at Juz Amma. How many surahs are in Juz Amma? They're always breaking, breaking, breaking. This is why it's called Mufassal. Right? The Mufassal are those surahs that are short. Lots of breaks. They always break because the surah finishes. So this is from Qaf to Surah Nas. So this shows us that of the blessings of Surah Yaseen, which are authentically narrated, is that it is a surah that has been given to our Prophet instead of the what? Injil of Jesus Christ. And this is very fitting because, as we will discuss tomorrow, inshallah, the surah begins with a story about Jesus Christ. The three people, right? We'll talk about this. It actually is a story that deals with Jesus Christ. And this is a very relevant introduction to the Mathani. Now, that's one blessing of Surah Yaseen. This is authentic. But it is not explicit about Surah Yaseen. It's a generic hadith about all of the surahs. The second hadith is a hadith narrated from Al-Hasan al-Basri from Abu Hurairah from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which says, whoever recites Surah Yaseen in one night seeking Allah's pleasure, all of his sins will be forgiven. Whoever recites Surah Yaseen in one night, all of it in one night, for the sake of Allah, seeking Allah's pleasure, all of his past sins will be forgiven. And this hadith is a hadith narrated in Ad-Darimi Sunan. Sunan Ad-Darimi is the name of the book. It is not one of the famous books of hadith. The famous books of hadith are six. There are six famous books of hadith. Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nisa'i, Ibn Majah. These are the famous six books of hadith. But there are more books beyond the six. And this book is called the Sunan of Ad-Darimi, and it is one of the books beyond the six books. And this chain, it has a slight weakness in it. Why? Because Al-Hasan al-Basri He never met Abu Hurayrah. Al-Hasan al-Basri was from the city of Basra, that's why he's called Hasan al-Basri. And Abu Hurayrah died in Medina. And Hasan al-Basri, and he died in the year 54 Hijrah. Abu Hurayrah died 54. And in the year 54 Hijrah, Al-Hasan al-Basri was a very young child in Basra. And he never went to Medina until after Abu Hurayrah died. So Hasan al-Basri never met Abu Hurayrah. So we say this hadith has what is called a missing link. Because Abu Hurayrah and Hasan al-Basri never met. So there is a slight weakness in this hadith. Now, question. What if a hadith is weak, what does that mean? What do we do with this hadith? And this is a tangent that is not related directly to our class, but you should be aware of this controversy, and you should know what is the status of a weak hadith in our religion. Realize that a hadith has been divided into many categories. For our purposes, we can divide them into five basic categories. For our purposes, we can divide a hadith into five categories. The first of these is called Sahih Hadith. And Sahih means it's grade A. Bukhari and Muslim are Sahih. The second category is Hasan. And Hasan means grade B, it's good, it's acceptable. And both Sahih and Hasan, they can be used for theology, for fiqh, for everything. The third category is Da'if. And Da'if means it's weak. When will a hadith be weak? That's a science of hadith, that's a whole science. When will a hadith be weak? There's 30, 40 reasons why a hadith might be weak. This is the third category, Da'if, it's called weak. And Da'if is like, let's say a C minus, let's say, right? And then you have the fourth category, Da'if Jiddan, very weak. And very weak is like a D. And then you have the fifth category, and that is fabricated. And fabricated means you know for sure that our Prophet did not say it. We know at some point in time somebody lied, astaghfirullah. Somebody lied about our Prophet and then spread a hadith about him. And we know for a fact that he never said this hadith. And fabricated hadith, of course, by unanimous consensus, they can never be used. And in fact, it is haram to even quote them unless you demonstrate that they're fabricated. You're never even allowed to quote fabricated hadith except to point out it is fabricated. And unfortunately, there are many fabricated hadith that are popular amongst Muslim circles. Of the most famous of them is seek knowledge even if you have to go to China. This hadith is completely fabricated. Our Prophet has never uttered the word China, nor did he utter this hadith of seek knowledge even if you have to go to China. And it is a well-known fabricated hadith. Never, the Prophet never said it. Now, what do we do if a hadith is fabricated? We warn against it. What do we do if a hadith is sahih or hasan A and B? We use it. This leaves two categories, da'if and da'if jiddan. By unanimous consensus, da'if jiddan, very weak, cannot be used for anything. Very weak, it's a D, D minus. There's some major problems in it. This is something we completely leave aside. The controversy occurs over da'if hadith, which is the CC minus, right? What is to be done with da'if? Da'if means we're not sure that the Prophet said it. Maybe he said it, maybe he didn't. We're not sure. And this is the classic example of da'if. Hasan al-Basri did not meet Abu Hurairah. We know for a fact he didn't meet him, right? So there's a missing link. So then we don't know who this intermediary is. It could be somebody who's not trustworthy. It could be somebody who has a faulty memory. It's unknown. Because we don't know, we cannot verify the hadith, so it becomes da'if. So what is to be done with the da'if hadith? This is a big controversy amongst scholars. And you have extreme positions. On the one hand, you have those who say we can never use da'if hadith. And they shun the use of da'if hadith totally. On the other hand, you say, no big deal, we will use da'if hadith, even if it's CC minus, no big deal. But that doesn't make sense, because when there's a doubt about the hadith, how can we use it as a statement of the Prophet? So the correct position, the middle position, which is the position of the majority of the ummah, the position of the majority of the ummah is that A da'if hadith can only be used with three conditions. You have to have three conditions, then you can use it. The first condition, that it actually be da'if and not da'if jidnat or fabricated. It can't be very weak or fabricated. And this requires a scholar of hadith to judge. What is the level of this hadith? Is it weak or is it very weak? This is the first condition. The second condition, that it not be used in theology or law, aqidah or fiqh, but it only be used in what is called in Arabic tarhib and tarhib, which means generic elements of good. Encouragement of good deeds, generically. For example, a hadith that says a particular surah has a certain blessing. We know all surahs have blessings. So if a da'if hadith comes and adds a blessing, then we may use it because the Quran is blessed, we already know. So if the hadith comes and says, okay, for another hadith comes about the blessings of charity, let's say. We already know that charity is good. If a hadith adds another blessing, we might as well encourage the people to give charity. For example, a hadith mentions that, and it's slightly weak in Tirmidhi, that the one who memorizes the Quran, his parents will have crowns of light placed on their head. Taj min nur, placed on their heads. Right? Now the hadith is slightly weak. Is memorizing the Quran something praiseworthy or not? Yes. So, we can use a da'if hadith to encourage something that is already praiseworthy. Right? This is the second condition. That it be used for something that is already established in the Sharia. And then the third condition, that when a person quotes a da'if hadith or acts upon it, they should be aware that the hadith is weak, and therefore, don't treat it like of A grade or B grade hadith, like a hasan or sahih hadith. They should treat it with a little bit of healthy skepticism and then hope for the reward, but know that the hadith might be weak. So there should be knowledge that the hadith is weak. Therefore, if you look at these three conditions, do they apply with this hadith, whoever recites Yaseen in one night, all of his sins will be forgiven? Do they apply? Yes. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, they apply. We can apply this hadith. So, we can quote this hadith, but we have to apply the third point, which is to point out it is weak, and that if somebody acts upon it, they hope for the reward, but they're not certain about the reward. This is the second hadith that we will do. We'll bring for Salah Shalom in 10 minutes. The third hadith that we'll do is a hadith that is perhaps the most famous about the blessings of Surah Yasin. And it is a hadith narrated by Anas ibn Malik that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, everything has a heart. And the heart of the Quran is Yasin. لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَلْبٌ وَقَلْبُ الْقُرْآنِ يَاسِينَ. Whoever reads it, it is as if he has read the Quran 10 times. Whoever reads it, it is as if he has read the Quran 10 times. Now this hadith is the most famous hadith about Surah Yasin because it is reported in At-Tirmidhi. Because it is reported in Sunan At-Tirmidhi. And Sunan At-Tirmidhi, as you know, is one of the famous 6 books. And generally speaking, the hadith that occur in the 6 books are more well known to the Ummah because Allah has blessed those 6 books to be accepted by the Ummah. Now, Imam At-Tirmidhi narrated this hadith, but he himself pointed out that this hadith is weak. And in fact, when you look at its chain, it's not only weak, it is very weak. Why? Because there are 2 unknown narrators in this hadith, back to back. 2 unknown narrators. So you're narrating from X, from Y in the chain. Literally, we don't know them. They're just names. We don't have any biographies, any details about them. And when you have 2 unknown narrators, it diminishes from being weak to being very weak. And because the hadith is very weak, we really cannot use this in the blessings of Surah Yasin. Also, our scholars point out, one of the signs of a strange hadith is if the meaning is strange. And this is something the scholars of hadith will do, not average Muslims. The scholars of hadith are the experts, not the average Muslim. The scholars of hadith have a sense of something is not right. These are not the words that we're used to hearing from the Prophet ﷺ. And one of the signs of a strange hadith is that immense blessings are given for something very small. And here we have, if you read Surah Yasin, you will get the reward of 10 full Qur'ans. And that does not make sense. Surah Yasin is 5-6 pages. And to say that this one surah will give you times 10 of the whole Qur'an, it does not make sense. When Surah Ikhlas will give you 1/3 of the Qur'an, that is a big blessing. Now you're saying, or somebody saying, Yasin is times 10 of the whole Qur'an. That doesn't make sense. And there's something in the heart that shows this hadith seems very strange. So, this hadith is very weak, and we cannot use it for the blessings of Yasin. That everything has a heart, and the heart of the Quran is Yasin. Whoever reads it, it is as if he has read the Quran 10 times. The fourth hadith that we will do is a hadith that is narrated by Ma'qal ibn Yasar, the famous companion Ma'qal ibn Yasar, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Baqara is the pinnacle of the Qur'an. An ayat of Kursi has been taken from under the throne of Allah. And Yasin is the heart of the Qur'an. So once again we have the phrase, Yasin is the heart of the Qur'an. No one reads it for the sake of Allah, except that his sins are forgiven. Now this phrase has already come. In which hadith? The hadith of Sunan al-Tirmidhi already has come. No one reads it for the sake of Allah except that all of his sins are forgiven. So, our Prophet said, recite it over your dead. Recite it over your dead. This hadith is reported in Abu Dawood's Sunan. Sunan of Abu Dawood. And also, for reasons we're not going to go into right now, the scholars have pretty much all pointed out and agreed that this hadith is very weak as well. Not just weak, but very weak. So this hadith, it has two, both of the previous phrases. Number one, Yasin is the qalb of the Quran. Number two, whoever reads it will be forgiven. But it has an added phrase. And what is that added phrase? Recite it over your dead. Recite it over your dead. And the meaning of recite it over your dead is to recite it over the one who's about to die. To recite it over the one who's on his deathbed. Not to recite it after somebody has died. Rather, to recite it over the one who is on his deathbed. Now, this hadith is also very weak, so we will put this aside as well. The final hadith is not actually a hadith. It is something from the Sahaba. It is something from the Sahaba. And this, the technical term is athar. Athar is statement of the Sahaba. And it is narrated by Udayf ibn al-Harith al-Thumali, who was a companion. Udayf ibn al-Harith al-Thumali was a companion of the Prophet. And he said, or it was narrated from him, that when he was dying on his deathbed, he asked the people around him, does anybody memorize Surah Yasin? And they said, here is a man who has memorized Yasin. So Hudayl said, can you recite Yasin over me? So the young man recited Surah Yasin over Hudayl. He recited Surah Yasin over Hudayl. And when he reached the 40th verse, Hudayl passed away, he died. And the narration goes on. They used to say that reciting Yasin over the dead makes the death easier. Reciting Yasin over the dead, meaning the one who's about to die, makes the death easier. Now, this is not a hadith technically, because there's no mention of the Prophet. But it's a mention of something the Prophet's companions did for life. And the Prophet's companions, what they said and did, it doesn't come to the level of a hadith, no doubt, but it still has a certain respect and a certain status in the Sharia. And therefore, because Hudayf asked somebody to read Yasin over him when he's about to die, so this shows us that there is some basis for this action. And therefore, the majority of scholars have said that it is mustahab, it is encouraged when somebody is on their deathbed and they're about to die, that somebody recites Yasin over them. It is encouraged to do so. And if you look at the theme of the surah, if you look at the content of the surah, this makes sense. Because the surah deals with Yawm al-Qiyamah, deals with resurrection, deals with the afterlife. And especially one verse is a very perfect verse for the one who's about to die. One verse in particular fits in perfectly with the concept of somebody who is about to die. And that verse is قِيلَ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي وَجَعْلَنِي مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ. It was said to him, go ahead and enter Jannah. And he said, how I wish my people knew that Allah has forgiven me and Allah has honored me. And that's a perfect ayah for somebody who is about to die. It's a very optimistic ayah. And it fits in perfectly with the concept of reciting Surah Yasin over the one who is about to die. The final point before we break for Salah and then come back. Why was Surah Yasin revealed? What is the sabab of nuzul of Surah Yasin? Is there any story, sabab nuzul means, why, what was the incident that caused the revelation of Surah Yasin? If you look at the books of Tafseer and the books of Seerah, one finds a number of incidents or stories that might possibly be causes for revealing Surah Yasin. Of these stories that are narrated, Ibn Ishaq mentions that on the night of the Hijrah, on the night of the Hijrah, when the Prophet ﷺ was surrounded by the people of Quraysh who wanted to kill him, and Jibreel came and told him to leave his house, the Prophet ﷺ left his house and recited Yasin. So he recited Yasin on the night of the Hijrah. And the first page of Yasin, the first paragraph, it says that, and we have put barriers in front of them and barriers behind them, and we have blinded them. فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. And our Prophet ﷺ recited these verses, and the people around him were blinded, and they could not see him. The people around him were blinded, and they could not see him, and he simply walked out from literally under their noses, and he threw dust on them, and they did not even know he had gone until after he had left. Now, this story does not show us why Yasin was revealed. Yasin was revealed way before this, but it simply shows us how it was used once. So Surah Yasin was not revealed on the night of the Hijrah. Surah Yasin was revealed before this. When exactly was it revealed? We don't know. We don't know the exact order of most of the surahs in Revelation. However, most scholars say Surah Yasin is a middle Makki surah. Middle, roughly in the middle of the Makkah era. Around 4 or 5 years after the beginning of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Surah Yasin is a middle Makkah surah. Another story that is narrated that might be one of the reasons why Yasin was revealed. It is said that once one of the leaders of the Quraysh by the name of Al-As ibn Wa'id, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he waved a rotting bone, a decaying bone in front of his face, mocking him, and said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you expect me to believe that أَوَيُحْيِ اللَّهُ هَذَا الْعِظَامُ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ, do you tell me that after this bone has decayed, Allah will bring it back to life? And in the end of Surah Yasin, as we'll talk about tomorrow night, inshallah ta'ala, in the very end of Surah Yasin, what does it say? That, وَقَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِ الْعِظَامُ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ, قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم. They mock and they say, will Allah be able to resurrect this dead bone? And Allah says, yes indeed, Allah will be able to resurrect it when He has prayed to the heavens and the earth. Why can He not do this? So this could be a possible incident that occurred that catered to the revelation of Yasin. That Al-As ibn Wa'in is mocking, and so Allah reveals this surah. A third story is narrated as well about Surah Yasin. And it is because of this story that some scholars have said that Yasin is a Madani surah. But this is a minority opinion. The vast majority of scholars, and it is the correct position, is that Yasin is a Makkan surah. But some one or two scholars of the past, they said Yasin is a Madani surah. Why? Because of one incident or one story. And this story is reported in Sahih Bukhari, so it's authentic. And it goes as follows. We learn that the tribe of Banu Salama, one of the tribes of Medina, they were praying every day with the Prophet ﷺ, and their houses were very far away. It would take them more than an hour, hour and a half to get to the Masjid. And they would pray with the Prophet ﷺ every day. So this proved very problematic for them to walk all the way, then walk all the way back. So they decided to sell their houses and sell their lands and sell their property and resettle closer to the Prophet in question. A very big thing for them to do. The news reached the Prophet that they're going to change houses and come closer. So Allah revealed in the Quran that إِنَّا نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ. We write down what good deeds they have sent forward, and we write down their footsteps. وَآثَارَهُمْ. We write down their footsteps. So the Prophet said, يَا بَنِي سَلَمَا دِيَارُكُمْ تُكْتَبُ آثَارُكُمْ دِيَارُكُمْ تُكْتَبُ آثَارُكُمْ. O Banu Salama, stay in your houses, Allah is writing your footsteps. Stay in your houses, Allah is writing your footsteps. Now, clearly, this is a Madani incident because the Banu Salama and the Masjid are in Medina. So some scholars have misunderstood and they said Surah Yasin therefore came down after this incident. But the correct position is that the Prophet ﷺ used an ayah that had already been revealed in Mecca. He used it for this incident. So the incident does not precede the revelation of Yasin. Rather, our Prophet ﷺ used it to prove something for them, and that is Allah writes down even your footsteps to the Masjid, and therefore where you are, that is good for you. So stay there, every footstep that you take, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you. So the farther away you are, the more blessings you will get. So stay where you are, and all of those blessings will be given to you on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And with this, we'll break for Salat al-Maghrib.